Thank you. It's so good to be back here. Thank you all for coming today. This is a very large, this book keeps getting larger. I thought that might be your notebook there. I had a suspicion. I was hoping. Good to see. We were just getting started. I'm going to provide first a update on our policy priorities for the 69th session of the UN General Assembly, which, as you know, is scheduled to start very soon. Next week is the high-level week. The president, the secretary will be there next week, but I'm going to talk through just a couple issues we're going to be focused on at UNGA, and then happy, as always, to take your questions. Obviously, UNGA is always an important time of the year for us. We believe that international cooperation is really essential to make progress towards any of the goals we're working towards. Obviously, there are a number of security goals which tend to get the most press, but also goals of sustainable development, human rights, democracy, prosperity. These are issues that are really best addressed by everyone in the world to the extent that we can all play a role. Obviously, first, I would start with this fight against ISIL that I know you've all been very focused on. Secretary Kerry is in Paris today working to build this coalition that we are putting together to take on this very serious threat. Although any strategy, of course, to counter ISIL must include a military component, which, again, I think gets a lot of the press, a comprehensive approach is really required. And I think you've heard the president and the secretary speak to that. The capabilities of other nations around the world certainly vary, but there's much that every country can do to improve security, share information, cut off financing, curb recruitment, furnish humanitarian aid to victims, and really expose the lies of this ideology that ISIL is trying to promote, certainly in Iraq and Syria. That's something we'll be very focused on at UNGA. Towards that end, Secretary Kerry will travel to New York this Friday, just for the day, to chair a ministerial debate of the United Nations Security Council on Iraq as part of the U.S. presidency of the Security Council in the month of September. He will convene the council to demonstrate broad and unified international support for the new Iraqi government and emphasize the need for broad political inclusivity as the new government pursues its agenda on behalf of the Iraqi people. The council session this Friday will also provide a platform for the international community to underscore its support for Iraq's new government as it responds to the threats from ISIL and the humanitarian situation. I think this will be a good session going into the high-level week at UNGA next week, which will, of course, be very focused on ISIL as part of our discussions there. A second issue I think I should highlight now is our effort to ensure that Iran does not acquire a nuclear weapon. As you know, we've been involved in negotiations since last year. It's been only a year, which is sort of crazy to think about, since they started last year at UNGA. These are led by EU High Representative Cathy Ashton with the members of the P5+1. These will resume this week. We are all headed up to New York and will continue through the high-level week. As you know, the Joint Plan of Action was extended through November 24th. So we will have a lot of people in New York focused on experts meeting, coordination meeting, bilateral meetings, big plenary sessions to see if we can move this forward. Our talks have been serious, and they've identified potential answers to key questions, but we remain far apart on some core issues. Iran's leaders have repeatedly disavowed any desire to build a nuclear weapon, and we believe this negotiation offers them a chance to match their words with verifiable actions and want them and all of us to take this diplomatic opportunity to resolve this really pressing diplomatic challenge peacefully. Obviously, this will be a key topic at UNGA as well. Just a few more I will mention here. Obviously, the Middle East has been in the news quite a bit as of late, as I think it always is. But in Ukraine, we are also very focused on working together at UNGA. We look forward to the full implementation of the peace plan that has been negotiated, despite even some setbacks, some fairly serious setbacks just today on the ground. Both Ukraine and Russia have voiced support for the plan, but there now must be sustained follow-through on the ground, and everyone must do their part. The principles at play here, and I think this is something you'll hear at the General Assembly, are really principles that are key to every country around the world. The principle that no attempt should be made to alter international boundaries through external aggression underpins really every country that sits around at the UN General Assembly table next week. That principle has been violated in Ukraine by Russia. You've seen us put sanctions in place, and you've seen us say we will put more in place if the aggression does not subside. Just a few other points I'll mention about what we're focused on at the General Assembly, and then I promise I will open it up to all of your questions. We'll have some conversations about Afghanistan and the path forward there. NATO and the Afghan government are in the final stages of a long-planned security transition, as you know, and we are obviously in conversations about what our post-2014 presence will look like, even as the Afghan people have voted to effect a change in political leadership that will really influence the direction of the future of their country. The UN is playing a pivotal role here in support of this electoral process. It's ongoing, but hopefully we will have some resolution soon. That's something we'll have conversations about. Of course, when it comes to West Africa, the United States is participating in an emergency effort to assist those on the front lines of the battle against the Ebola virus. I think you will hear a number of conversations around the General Assembly about combating this issue. We certainly have unique resources we can bring to bear, but other countries do as well, and it's a very serious health challenge, certainly, that we are putting increased resources towards. I think you'll hear the president speak about that a little bit as well in the coming days. And finally, I'd mention just a few other topics. There are many that come up at the General Assembly, but just a few others I would mention. One is climate change. We must act together to curb climate change through better environmental practices and energy smart technologies that will not only protect the Earth, but also help economies grow. You will hear a lot about climate change at different times throughout the General Assembly, particularly at the high-level week next week. We'll also be talking about defending civil society, human rights, democracy, freedom of the press, full participation of women, all these things that we don't necessarily always get as much press attention, but that are really critical to the work the UN is doing. When we talk about the post-2015 Millennium Development Goals, what underpins a lot of those are these really important efforts to bring people in societies around the world to have better civil society, to have more democracy, to have more participation of women. Again, these aren't always in the headlines or the limelight, but I think they're just as important. Along with climate change, one last thing I'll mention is that there will be, I think, quite a bit of attention on the oceans issue. You know, Secretary Kerry hosted a high-level oceans conference at the State Department a few months ago now, I think it was. And I think here at the Foreign Press Center, there may be an event this Wednesday at 2 p.m. with some of our colleagues from NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, on this topic of what we'll be discussing in UNGA and really on how we keep our oceans clean and help protect our planet, which again doesn't get the headlines, but probably should. So I'd encourage you all, that's a little plug for the Foreign Press Center, but I would encourage all of you to attend because these are all issues that I know our team will be focused on at UNGA. There are a whole other set of issues I don't even have time to mention in my opening, but why don't I stop there and open it up for some questions about priorities for next week or foreign policy in general. And I'm going to go ahead and call them. And again, please identify yourself and your outlet. I'm going to go down the front row. So I'm going to start with you right here.
Thank you.
And wait for the microphone.
Sure. Thank you. Many thanks. I'm Luis Alonso with the AP. And I would like to ask you about Western Hemisphere, Latin America. Mm-hmm. Venezuela has gathered support from many countries in the region to run for the seat in the Security Council. And I would like to ask you, do you think Venezuela represents appropriately the values of the region? And is the U.S. going to do anything to try to oppose or find an alternative to Venezuela in the Security Council? Thank you.
Well, it's my understanding that Venezuela is still running unopposed on the Latin America and Caribbean group slate, if that's correct. If that hasn't changed, hopefully it hasn't. Obviously, the U.S. is not a member of that regional slate. But we've made clear that regional groups have a responsibility to put forward candidate countries that support the principles of the UN Charter, contribute to the Security Council's role in maintaining international peace and security, and uphold and advance human rights. We obviously don't publicly discuss our private diplomatic conversations or our voting intentions, I think, as everyone knows. But our concerns with regard to Venezuela's human rights record, certainly, and democratic governance are well known. But again, we are not a member of this group, and we will wait and see what happens. I'm going to go down the front row here. Go ahead, yes.
You have already mentioned you will address the ISIS issue during the UNGA. So can you elaborate more about what is your goal, and how mm-hmm. we'll address that? And do you have any expectations from China?
Well, in general, I think what you've seen in this coalition building process that we've been undertaking for a while now have been several steps. First, you saw the president and the secretary go to the NATO summit in Wales, where they sat down with our closest NATO allies to start having a conversation about a comprehensive strategy to fight ISIL. You saw some contributions or commitments come out of that. Then the secretary went to the Middle East, to Saudi Arabia, to Turkey, to Iraq, where he was there right after they had put a new government in place, to talk about the really key role that the Arab states particularly, but also countries like Turkey and others, can play in this coalition. If you saw the communique that came out of Jeddah from his meetings there, a number of countries pledged a great deal of support to this coalition. Now he's in Paris today, where we're really marrying up the European part of the coalition and a lot of the Arab states who are there as well. And then on top of that, we have the General Assembly, where the whole world comes together. And really, I think every country around the world has a role they could play here. And so taking that coalition we've started building and the principles underpinning it and all the different ways you can contribute and making that on a global scale, I think there will be a number of conversations happening at the General Assembly about how we can best confront ISIL. The president, as you know, will be chairing a session on combating foreign fighters to focus specifically on Iraq and Syria. So coming out of UNGA, I think we just would like to see an even broader and deeper and bigger, I think, coalition when it comes to fighting ISIL. Again, people focus a lot on the military side of this, but there are so many ways. I mean, a huge way is cutting off the financing or speaking out against their ideology. There are a number of other countries. That's a huge way they can be helpful. So I think those are conversations you'll see happening at the General Assembly when the whole world is in New York. And hopefully coming out of that, we'll see an even bigger coalition to fight this threat. Not any specifically that I know of. Obviously, as a member of the Security Council, they'll be in Friday's session. They'll be in a number of other sessions. Any country that can play a role here to support the new inclusive Iraqi government, to support our partners on the ground, and to push back against this threat, obviously that would be something we welcome, including from China. Yes, go ahead.
Hi, Maris. Thank you for holding this. I'm Ching Yi Chen with Shanghai Media Group. And I'd like to know, actually, right after UNGA, President Obama is going to meet the Indian Prime Minister Modi in the White House. And we know Chinese President Xi Jinping is going to visit India this week. So I'd like to know, what's the expectation from the U.S. about the bilateral meeting between President Obama and Prime Minister Modi? And how does the U.S. view Prime Minister Modi's meeting with President Xi prior to his visit to the White House? Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Well, thank you for the question. I know we're all looking forward to welcoming Prime Minister Modi to Washington for a number of meetings, I'm sure, with my colleagues at the State Department as well. And this is a broad relationship we have with India in a whole host of areas, certainly security. I'm sure we'll talk a lot about security issues. Environmental issues, energy issues, economic issues. Our relationship with India really is a very broad one, where we talk about a whole range of topics. And I think that we want India to have good relationships with all the countries in the region, including China. So a lot of these areas, we have overlapping interests. So we certainly are welcoming the Prime Minister to Washington, have a full agenda, which I think we'll probably flesh out a little bit more as we get closer to his visit. But suffice to say, I think we will touch on a number of those topics I just mentioned, including, lastly, I should mention Afghanistan, which obviously is important to a lot of people, but to the Indians. And I think that'll certainly be a topic of conversation. Yes. Yes. And then is that a question in New York? I'm going to go to New York next. Sorry, I can't see with that one camera there. So.
Does it work?
Oh yes.
Thank you, Marie. And thanks to our friends at the FPC, as always. My name is...
Uh-oh.
Hello?
Just when you were about to identify.
I'll
the mic got cut.
My name is Andrei Sitov. I'm with TASS, the Russian news agency. A couple of things. In the context of Angar or any other context, do you expect any high-level contacts with the Russians, American Russians, in the next few weeks? On Ukraine, obviously the most important thing, what are you doing What are you prepared to do to strengthen the ceasefire? Mm-hmm. And lastly, you did mention the most important issue for you, the ISIL and the Syrian front in this struggle. In terms of aggression, how does it square with international norms? Bombing in Syria. Mm-hmm. I assume you will not be using direct permission or invitation from the government. Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay, let me start with question number one, but remind me if I forget one of your questions. We don't have a full schedule for the secretary yet at the General Assembly. Obviously, he's chairing this session on Friday of the Security Council. I don't know who will be there from Russia representing them. I can imagine that there will be conversations. I just don't have a full schedule for you yet, but I would expect certainly, in some way, there will be. Secondly, on the ceasefire? Yes. So it is increasingly strained, although we believe there's a path forward here where it can hold, and indeed we can have some de-escalation. There has been a recent surge in separatist attacks against Ukrainian positions around Donetsk over the weekend, particularly the assaults on Donetsk Airport. Also, some OSCE monitors came under attack, came under fire, and seen serious damage to their vehicles. So again, it's coming under increased strain here, but we believe there's a path forward. And what we said very clearly on Friday, I think it was Friday, when we announced additional sanctions, was that if Russia fully implemented the September 5th Minsk agreement, fully implemented that, there would be a path forward here just with the latest round of sanctions to pull those back. So what we need to see now is the September 5th Minsk agreement and all 12 steps contained in that ceasefire to be implemented. We've seen repeated violations of it by the separatists, and we need to see that changed.
So the logic is you first impose the sanctions, but then if the ceasefire holds, you withdraw the sanctions.
Well, no, the sanctions were in response to specific Russian actions that they had taken in Ukraine. Again, we've been very clear that if there's additional escalatory action in Ukraine, we will impose additional sanctions. We need to see de-escalation here. There's a path forward, but again, the ceasefire was increasingly strained over the weekend, and we need to see everybody take a step back from the brink here and move forward in a different path. And then the third question was... Oh, yes. Sorry. How could I forget? The president's been clear that when there are terrorist groups that threaten the United States or Americans, as ISIL has, as we've seen, grotesquely and brutally, and now with the United Kingdom as well, with those murders, that he has a responsibility as commander-in-chief, one that is enshrined both in the Constitution and in international law, to take steps to protect Americans. We believe the Assad regime has lost all legitimacy. We will not be coordinating with them. And we have the ability to take steps to protect Americans. I'm not going to outline what those steps might look like or get ahead of a process here, but he certainly made that clear a number of times. Thank you. I'm going to keep going down the front row, and then I'm moving to the rest of the room, I promise. Yes, go ahead. And then I'm going to New York. You got to remind me next time. I'm going to New York next. You're okay. Casually sneaking it in there. Yes, go ahead.
Okay, Mary. My name is Nadia Chow, Washington correspondent for Liberty Times Taiwan. Mm-hmm. Last week, the former AIT chairman, Richard Bush, said in a conference that he is confident that U.S. will say or do something to intervene in Taiwan's presidential election in 2016. And he mentioned the Financial Times interview at 2011, which criticized the opposition party. Just, I want to know U.S. government's position. Would you prefer any party or candidate based on its policy on China? What's U.S. policy on Taiwan's presidential election overall?
Well, I haven't seen those comments. To my knowledge, we don't, as we don't anywhere, take a position on who we would like to see anywhere as a leader of another place. Obviously, that's not something that we here take positions on. I mean, when it comes to Taiwan, as you're probably aware, we remain fully committed to the One China policy, to the three communiques, and our responsibilities under the Taiwan Relations Act. Beyond that, I don't have much more analysis of the election you mentioned. Again, I hadn't seen those comments. Now I'm going to New York. I reminded myself. Go ahead.
Hello there. It's James Reinel with Al Jazeera. couple of questions on efforts against the Islamic State. Mm-hmm. Can you give us any more details, flesh out what's going to be inside the UN resolution tackling the flow of foreign fighters? And can you clarify, is the U.S. going to seek U.N. authorization for the use of force in Syria?
Well, a couple points. I don't have anything new to preview for you in terms of any U.N. actions. Obviously, the secretary will be chairing this session on Friday about Iraq, and the president will have his own session on foreign fighters. So I don't have any other preview of that. And again, this president has made clear that we have the ability to take action where U.S. citizens are threatened. We haven't announced what specifically those actions will look like, so I don't have anything to preview for you in terms of what might follow such an announcement. Yes.
Hi, I'm Stefan Grober with Euronews European Television. Mm-hmm. You mentioned the Iran talks that continue this week. Could you speak a little bit about this? What is the state of affairs here right now? What are the biggest problems? Are there any bilateral meetings planned between U.S. and Iranian officials? Mm-hmm. And could a positive outcome of these talks lead to an opening to a U.S.-Iranian coordination in the fight against ISIL? Thank you.
Well, on the third question, we will not be coordinating with Iran in this fight against ISIS. So let me be clear about that. And the nuclear issue is a separate one. We have extended the Joint Plan of Action until November 24th, so we are still operating under everything that fell under the Joint Plan of Action, which means Iran's nuclear program cannot move forward. In response, we've agreed to suspend very limited sanctions in response to them freezing their nuclear program. So that's where we are right now. We have had a number of conversations, obviously, but this is the first big round since we extended the JPOA. As the other rounds have had, I am guessing, and we don't have a full schedule yet, I wish we did, but we don't, we'll include things like a full P5 plus one EU-Iran plenary session. If you've seen these, they're the ones that Kathy Ashton chairs as High Representative, the big plenaries. There'll be a number of side meetings with experts to work through the very technical pieces that need to go into this kind of nuclear agreement. There'll be internal coordination meetings among the P5 plus one, and I should say, that despite our differences on other issues, I don't mean to look at you when I say that, but despite our differences on other issues, we have remained remarkably unified when it comes to the Iran talks. So, and I also expect there will be bilaterals, as there always are at these sessions with all of the countries in Iran. I don't have a schedule for you yet, but we will start those talks as of the 18th in New York and expect them to go through the high-level week. As I said in my opening, we've made some progress here. We have put, we believe, fair, reasonable ideas on the table and are still somewhat far apart on some of the core issues here. This is really a decision that the Iranians have to make. They have said they do not want a nuclear weapon. That's not a hard proposition to prove. And all we're doing is asking them to prove it. Again, this is technically complicated. There's not just one right answer here. And we are being creative, we are asking them to be creative to see if we can get to yes here, because we have to be assured in any agreement that Iran cannot develop a nuclear weapon, that its program is for entirely peaceful purposes. And that's what I think what all of us in the P5 plus one want to see. But we do remain fairly far apart on some issues, and I think you'll see us get down to work again this week and see if we can narrow those gaps. Yes, and then I'm going around the rest of the room.
Very much. Jason Chang, Yonhap News Agency from South Korea. On the sidelines of this UN General Assembly, I think Secretary Kerry plans to attend a high-level meeting on North Korea's human rights record. And I heard that the Department of State is playing a leading role in organizing this meeting. Can you tell us about more about this meeting, like what its objective is and what Kerry's participation in it means?
Well, I don't have any additional details for you. I think we'll flesh that out over the coming days. But obviously, this is a topic we have been very outspoken about. The human rights situation in North Korea is incredibly poor based on the regime's actions and the steps they've taken to create that climate. So obviously, we've talked about this at the UN before. We've talked about it in other bodies as well. So as we get more details on that, I'm sure we'll be talking about them. But we have played a leading role in speaking out here. I mean, all you had to do today is look at an American citizen who was sentenced to a fairly severe sentence in North Korea for something that in most other countries wouldn't even be something you got arrested for. So I think that that's something we're very focused on. We've spoken out about it publicly. Certainly a top priority is our three American citizens who remain in prison in North Korea. But the more broadly, the human rights situation remains incredibly poor, and we want to bring other countries together to draw attention to it, to see if we can help push to get some change.
Invite the North Korean foreign minister to this meeting?
I have no idea who will be invited to this meeting. I don't have anything else to preview on it for you. Yes, I'm actually going to go somewhere in the back to this woman in the pink shirt. I'm sorry if I'm calling on you based on what you're wearing, but that's sort of easiest because I don't know all of you.
It's easy.
I know, it stands out. See, she has a strategic advantage.
Thank you. My name is Zina. I'm with Al Iraqiya TV. I'm actually interested in the flow of ISIL fighters through Turkey, and I know Secretary Kerry was in Turkey. What is the next step? Is Turkey taking any role in actually closing its border and ending the flow of fighters?
It is a big challenge, not just from Turkey, but other countries as well. And these countries know it's a big challenge. There are things they've committed to do to help try and cut off these flows of foreign fighters. We are particularly concerned about the Westerners and even the small number of Americans who have crossed the border, gone to fight with ISIS, and have a Western passport. So we are very focused from a security perspective on that. But you're right, the flow of foreign fighters is something we are working with the Turks, we are working with other countries in the region on every single day. And again, the reason the president is chairing this high-level session at the Security Council is because it's such a problem, to really get people focused on it and see if we can get some more commitments. But these are, you know, when it comes to the border between Iraq and Syria, it's very porous. So that's a huge challenge. The Iraqis are trying, but it is a huge, huge challenge. And again, a key part to cutting off ISIL's ability to continue to grow. I think when you talk about how you strategically push back a terrorist organization and reduce its capabilities, you first start, I think, by pushing them back from territory like they've taken in Iraq. But then you start starving them of the oxygen they need, and that's money and people. And that's what we're very focused on, particularly where you mentioned in Turkey. Yes, this woman right here. Yes. And then I'm going to New York, I promise.
My name is Maya Dasabri from At-Taghir Channel. Is the United States would only airstrike on terrorists for the Islamic State, despite the fact that some people talking about the this strike will not be fully effective for the elimination of regulation?
For the elimination of what? I'm sorry, I missed that last word.
Of regulation.
Well, I think that when we talk about the current coalition we're trying to build, it's just focused on ISIS. And there are a number of extremist groups in the region. There are a number of extremist groups around the world. But when we're talking about this current coalition that we're building, it is very focused just narrowly on ISIS. Now, narrowly, that's a huge number of people now. If you look at the latest assessments of the number of fighters that have gone to fight with ISIS, they're pretty big. So that's what we're focused on now. There are other tools we have to use against other terrorist groups. If you look at al-Nusra, who's also very active in Syria, we've taken steps to designate sources of funding and financing from the United States so we can cut off the funding that way. There are other steps we can take there as well. But when it comes to this specific coalition, it's about ISIS. And then I'm going to New York now.
Thank you, Madame Marie. This is Sylviane Zahil from Lorient Le Jour, Beirut. Lebanon is now facing enormous challenges, namely the expansion of ISIS, the beheading of two Lebanese soldiers plus 27 other soldiers taken hostage, and the presidential vacancy. Is there a risk of fragmentation of Lebanon as a state burdened by 1.5 million of Syrian refugees? What needs to be done by the international community and by the United States to keep the neutrality of Lebanon? With this will be discussed during the UNGA. Thank you.
Well, I think you're absolutely right. There are huge security challenges for Lebanon based on the spillover effect from Syria, particularly as ISIS has grown. We have repeatedly reiterated our support for Lebanon's stability, security, and sovereignty, and to that end have continued to support the Lebanese armed forces, the internal security forces, including with recently some additional assistance to the armed forces to help with this internal security situation. We know that the longer the civil war continues in Syria, the more likely violence will spill over to Syria's neighbors, including Lebanon. And so we are working very closely with them to increase their capabilities, to increase their ways they can fight this threat on their own. Obviously, we know there are a number of challenges, not just the Syrian civil war, but others. We have a very close relationship with Lebanon. I expect it may come up at the General Assembly. I would guess it would, but I don't have any specifics to preview for you. Thank you. I go to the gentleman right here in the white shirt with the glasses.
Thank you very much for hosting us here. My name is Markus Pinder. I work for the German National Public Radio System. Which countries have, as of today, offered military support for the United States fighting against ISIL?
Well, there's a number of countries who, up until this point, if you look at what we've done in Iraq, particularly on the humanitarian side, but on the resupply of the Kurdish forces and the Iraqi security forces with weapons, there's a number of countries who've said they will resupply these forces and help the Iraqis in their fight. When it comes to the broader military coalition that we're talking about now, I think there'll be a time and place to talk about specifics that we've talked about privately. I'll let each country announce their own intentions when it comes to how they will play a role here. But suffice to say, in all of the conversations the secretary has had, people want to help. The question is what that looks like. So in addition to the resupply that's been going on in Iraq and the support for humanitarian efforts there, I think you'll see increasingly other countries coming out and pledging additional ways of supporting, but I don't want to get ahead of them announcing that. Certainly there'll be, I think, a time and place to do so. Yes, let's go to the gentleman here, right, sitting, sorry, tweed jacket, sort of.
My name is Alexander Kristenko, TV channel Russia. Commander of Ukrainian voluntary military battalion, his name is Semen Semenchenko, just posted in Facebook that he landed in Washington, D.C., and he has several meetings with U.S. lawmakers in Congress, and particularly he's going to discuss in West Point Academy possible training of Ukrainian voluntary commanders. Can you confirm that and do you know the status of his visit? And regarding future visit of President Poroshenko, what's on the agenda? Maybe any, are there any changes in your position regarding lethal weaponry delivery?
Well, in terms of your first question, we're not aware of any U.S. officials who plan to meet with this commander, if we're talking about the same commander, while he's here. I can't speak for members of Congress, nor would they want me to, I don't think. So if there's some meetings up there, I'm happy for them to speak to those. But none on the U.S. executive branch side that I'm aware of. In terms of, I don't have more details for you on Mr. Poroshenko's visit. We have a number of requests for assistance from the Ukrainian government, and we are actively looking at what more we can do. I don't have any new announcements to make for you today. That process is ongoing. But I know a key part of the conversation when he's here will be what more we can do and how we can support them and how, as this fragile ceasefire continues, how we can take steps to help them in any way to really cement this in place. Thanks. Yes, I'm going to go to this woman right here with the nice necklace. Yeah. See, now I'm like a fashion commentator up here. I'm going to go to our colleague in New York. Yes.
Thank you for doing this. My name is Silvia Pisani. I am from La Nación newspaper in Argentina. I will take you to another topic of the United Nations Assembly. As you know, Argentina is going to push there again for a broad discussion of what can we do, what can be done against the action of the Bolter funds concerning the negotiation of the restructured foreign debt. I know that Washington said no to the proposal in the broad sense, mm-hmm. and now is going to start the particular discussion of the proposal. I would like to know if, by any way, the topic of the external debt and the Bolter Fund is going to be in the American agenda in the United Nations. If you're going to answer to the proposal in any way, or if you have any alternative to the proposal, or which will be the solution for the problem. Thank you so much.
A great three questions, which I have no answers to at the moment. I know you looked very disappointed. I'm sorry. Let me take it back to our team, who I know has been very focused on this, to see to get their thoughts on whether it will be a topic of discussion and where we stand heading into the General Assembly. It hasn't been something I've heard discussed in the terms that you mentioned. So let me just check with them and see. Make sure you touch base with my team, and we can get you something. I'm going to go to New York now.
Paolo Mastrolilli for the Italian daily newspaper La Stampa. Thank you for doing this. You say that you are not coordinating with Iran in terms of the ISIL issue. I'm reading now a report from Paris of the New York Times. They are quoting Secretary Kerry saying that it doesn't mean that we are opposed to the idea of communicating to find out if they will come on board or under what circumstances, or whether there is a possibility of a change. Could you elaborate on that? What do you expect to communicate with Iran about, and what kind of effect that could have also on the negotiation on the nuclear issue?
It's a great question. And first, on the nuclear issue, we really are setting these issues aside because we think the nuclear issue is so central to our security, to the world security, that we want to keep those talks separate so nothing else gets in the way of them. We are open to having conversations with the Iranians about what's happening in Iraq. We've had a few on the sidelines of previous nuclear negotiation rounds in Vienna, and may very well in New York as well. So we're clearly open to having a conversation about the threat posed by ISIL, which is also a threat to Iran. But we won't be coordinating with them, won't be talking about military action together, won't be sharing intelligence. But you know, they have an amount of influence in Iraq, and we want anyone who does to support this new government, to support the Iraqi security forces, the Kurdish forces, as the ones who really need to take the fight to ISIL. Yes, I'm going to go to this woman here in the blue.
Hi, Heba Al-Qudsi from Sharq Al-Awsat newspaper. Is there any updates about the Apache aeroplanes that U.S. repeatedly promised to deliver in Egypt? And will that Apache will be used against ISIS? And is there any other logistic services that you're asking Egypt to deliver in the coalition fighting ISIS?
I think the secretary spoke to the Apache issue after his meetings in Egypt and said we would be delivering them. I don't have a timing update for you. And I don't, in terms of ISIS, have anything in terms of related to the Apaches. Obviously, we talked to the Egyptians about what they could do to push back on this threat, but I don't have any specifics for you. But I know that the secretary did make clear that we will deliver the Apaches. Just no timing. Yes, the red tie. Yes. I like this.
Good choice of wardrobe. Mari, my name is Leszek Krawczyk. I'm a new TVP Polish television correspondent. So thank you for doing this. I'm happy to be here. And my question actually is concerning ISIL. How many of those guys are there? Because we hear sometimes 10,000, 20,000. What's the difficulty in this assessment? And also, after what happened to our colleagues, Jim Foley and Stephen Sutloff, I wonder if you reach out to media outlets and, I don't know, advise against sending people over there because of the, you know, risks they are taking. Thank you.
Yes, and I'm trying to find, I have the new numbers in this very large book of mine somewhere, so let me just find that. In terms of your first question, though, while I'm paging through this, or your second question while I'm paging through this book, we have very serious travel warnings in place for Syria, particularly. We know we need journalists to cover what's happening there. We need journalists to show the world the situation there so we can hopefully push people to act to try to resolve it. You play a key fundamental role in bringing to light the brutality of the Assad regime, of ISIS, and of other groups like al-Nusra. But we have very tough travel warnings in place because it is very dangerous. And we just, you know, many of you work in very risky and dangerous places because it's important. But it is, again, very dangerous. So we will do everything we can if Americans are taken hostage, like they were in this case, to find them and to bring them home. The president ordered an incredibly risky special operations raid into Syria to try to rescue Jim Foley and Stephen Sotloff and the small number of other Americans that were being held. Unfortunately, they had been moved. So we put every intelligence resource, every law enforcement resource, every diplomatic resource behind finding people and bringing them home because that's incredibly, incredibly important to us. In terms of the numbers, and I don't want to page through this book too much. I think I have the updated here. If you just give me one second, actually, I need to make sure I have the latest numbers. I also need to clean this book out. Was that your last question? Did you have another one while I page through here? I see you get another one. Look, this is your lucky day. I know it's in here. I just need a second to see if I can find it.
I was also curious, actually, you know, about the situation, because this weekend we heard from Diane Foley on CNN. She gave this interview, and I was just wondering if you could confirm that. Is it true that U.S. officials reach out to the Foley family and, I advise them not to try to negotiate, pay ransom, because they could face a possible persecution?
Okay, I found it, and I will answer your third question, too. This is what I get for not having a well-organized book. On your last question, then we'll go to the numbers. The U.S. government writ large was in very close contact with the Foley family and all the families. At the State Department, Secretary Kerry, his chief of staff, David Wade, knew the Foleys from when Jim had been abducted in Libya, worked very closely with them. We have tried to provide every amount of comfort we can. This is the worst thing this family has ever gone through. And I don't ever want to second guess or judge the motives of people who speak out after such a horrific loss. I will be clear that no one at the State Department ever would have, nor would we have ever intended to say anything that was deemed threatening. When the family had questions of us or the FBI or the NSC or anyone else about what our laws say, we have an obligation to give them the information. But to my knowledge, no one was threatened with prosecution. But again, I can only speak for what I can speak for. We at the State Department take our responsibility to these families incredibly seriously. I know the Secretary does, and are still standing by to provide any assistance we can. When it comes to the numbers, we assess that ISIL can muster between 20,000 and 31,500 fighters across Iraq and Syria based on a new review of all-source intelligence reports from May to August, an increase from our previous assessment, I think, of about at least 10,000 fighters. Intelligence experts arrived at this new assessment after completing an exhaustive review of all-source intelligence reports. It reflects an increase in ISIL's fighters because of the group's stronger recruitment since June because of some of their battlefield successes. Greater battlefield activity. And these estimates are, in some respects, an art, not a science. They're based on information, but they're often very difficult to pin down. So I think that, especially having worked in that world, we have ranges of numbers for a reason, but we do know they've grown in strength. We do know there are a number of Americans who have gone to fight with ISIS, a number of Westerners. So obviously that's something we are very, very focused on. And thank you for giving me a moment to find my numbers. I need to clean this book out. Yes, this woman right here.
Thank you. Manar Ghonim, Middle East News Agency. Mm-hmm. I have two questions. The first one is regarding the recent decision taken by Qatar to expel seven of Muslim Brotherhood leaders. So how do you see such a decision, which come, in fact, after one day from when former Vice President Dick Cheney said that Muslim Brotherhood is the ideological source of militant groups around the most militant groups around the world? This is the first question.
Okay, I'll do the first one, then you can ask a second one. I've seen those media reports. Actually, can't confirm them. I'd refer you to the government of Qatar for more information. I just can't confirm that it's actually happening. The U.S. has not designated the Muslim Brotherhood as a foreign terrorist organization, as I think many of you know. This is a complex issue, and you will not be surprised that I disagree with the former vice president on this and probably a number of other things.
Discussions in Cairo. Mm-hmm. Did the discussions cover any American assistance to Egypt in its fight on terrorism regarding mm-hmm. in addition to the discussions on building the coalition against ISIL.
They did, and we talked about the Apaches and how we will soon be delivering those. We talked about a whole host of security issues, also human rights issues, issues of freedom of the press. So all of those were discussed while we were there, really focused on the anti-ISIL coalition. But we do know that Egypt faces a terrorism challenge, particularly in Sinai. And that's why the assistance we've continued to provide to Egypt has been in large part focused on that, because we know it's a challenge. We know they need resources, and we have unique capabilities we can bring to bear. I'm going to go next to you.
Thank you. I'm Andreas Ross with the German newspaper Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung. Back to the fight and airstrikes in Syria. Now, mm-hmm. The Russians aren't the only ones that are reminding the Americans of the Security Council in New York. Even some of your self-declared European allies are more quietly asking for some form of international legitimacy to any such attacks, also because they are afraid of losing the moral high ground when they're dealing with Russia on other fronts. So, asking you again, do you exclude reaching out in any form or shape during UN week to the United Nations as a body for giving some sense of legitimacy to what the president has announced in terms of Syria? And also, if I may, on the foreign fighters, can you at least, in the Security Council session, can you at least confirm there's supposed to be a resolution that's being worked on, and to what extent do you expect that to have specific measures mm-hmm. as opposed to more symbolic underlining of people's outrage?
That's my understanding on the second part, but I don't have specifics for you. And obviously, I think that's all still being discussed and ahead of the session. But obviously, we believe it's important to talk about this with our counterparts in the Security Council. That's why the Secretary is chairing this session on Friday. We will have a number of conversations with our UN partners during UNGA about actions against ISIL. I don't have anything more to preview for in terms of what that might look like or what we might put on the table. But when U.S. citizens are murdered on video, when British citizens now are brutally murdered on video, and we know there are more that they're holding, when they threaten the United States directly, when they kill anyone in their path, including, again, now Americans, the commander-in-chief has a responsibility and a duty to act. And that's what you heard him say the other night. Any action we take will be consistent, of course, with international law. But I don't have anything to preview for you in terms of what might happen during the General Assembly week or at the UN writ large. Yes, I'll go to you over here.
Thank you very much. My name is... Does it work?
It's not working.
My name is Martin. Check with the Czech television. I have one more question on ISIS, if I may.
Yeah.
Today, Czech Republic became one of the members of the gathering in Paris that pledged to support mm-hmm. Iraqis
yes.
By training, by humanitarian assistance, mm-hmm. ammunition as well. So I just wonder, what is your reaction to these pledges made not only today in Paris but elsewhere and in other times as well? Plus, how does it work? Do you have a set of requirements that you want from each and every country that is willing to help? Or do you just wait and see what they come up with? Thank you.
Well, on the first point, we certainly welcome the support. I think the meeting in Paris today was an important one to show another grouping of countries coming together and saying this is a shared challenge to our security and we're going to fight it together. We welcome those pledges of support and pledges of commitments. In the second question, we know each country has unique capabilities they can bring to bear, and each one will be different. So part of what we're doing right now is the very painstaking work of diplomacy. And this is an effort led by retired General John Allen. You may have seen this announcement last week, to talk to these countries, all of them, and say, OK, what resources do you have? What do you think you can do? Because, again, the U.S. is playing a key leading role here. But the Iraqi government, all of this is being done in coordination with the Iraqi government. They're coming to us and saying, we need this, we need that when it comes to Iraq. And when it comes to the broader fight, we are having that dialogue with countries and talking to them to say, what do you think you can do? Here's what we think you can do, or a way you could be helpful. And quite frankly, I will say we have had very good responses and reception from countries who see what ISIS is doing and want to do something to help, anything. They don't want them to grow in strength. In fact, they want to help push them back if there's anything they can do. This is not going to be like a coalition I think we've seen in the past, really unlike anything we've ever done. Yes, I'll go to this woman right here with the very pretty scarf on. That's you, yes. She's looking around like maybe it's someone else.
Thank you. I represent the French daily newspaper Le Figaro. My name is Laure Mandeville. I have two questions. The first one about Turkey. How would you define the relationship between the U.S. and Turkey at the moment, at the moment when Turkey seems extremely reluctant to even offer the logistics of their bases in Incirlik? Is it disappointing for the U.S.? And would you confirm the information that Turkey is still providing weapons to Islamic radicals in Syria, including the Islamic State? I've seen in serious publications, American publications, such information. And the second question is about the hostages. The New York Times, I think 2 days ago, signaled that President Obama expressed in some meetings his disappointment with France for dealing with hostages by paying ransoms, and that this is not the way to go. So I know that the U.S. has been pushing for months a resolution on the how to deal with hostages. Mm-hmm. Do you have any hopes that you're going to get somewhere, or on this very sensitive question, mm-hmm. do you think that everyone is going to go his own way? Thank you.
No, thank you for the questions. I will start with the second one first, without getting into specifics about what we talk about in diplomatic conversations. We have been very clear that the reason we don't pay ransom to terrorists is because all that does is fuel more terrorism. We don't want U.S. money going to ISIS to contribute to more kidnappings. It puts American citizens at risk overseas, and it provides funding to terrorists to carry out their actions, including possibly threatening the United States. In addition to it being illegal in the United States, obviously, this is a part of our law here. But the principle that underpins it is one we feel very strongly about, and we have encouraged other countries to not pay ransom for this reason. That the main source of funding for ISIS is criminal activities like kidnapping for ransom, also bank robberies, petty theft, and things like that. It's also an ideological tool. What's an ideological tool? Well, I think that I think a couple things. I think that the president made very clear that we will find and hold accountable anyone responsible for these brutal murders. And if you look at our track record of doing that, no matter how long it takes, we do that in the United States. So there will be justice here for Jim Foley and Stephen Sotloff. And I think David Cameron said made some similar comments as well. But we don't pay ransom because we don't want it to go towards fueling more terrorism. It's a vicious cycle that has really fueled these kind of terrorist groups, something we feel very strongly about. I'm sorry, I forgot your first question now. Oh, yes, thank you. Turkey is a close NATO ally. Secretary was just there. We know each country can contribute in their own ways, and we know there are certain sensitivities for certain countries contributing in certain ways, obviously. But we've talked to the Turks a lot about counterterrorism. We have a close counterterrorism relationship. One thing, speaking to your colleague's question, we talked to them about is cutting off foreign fighter flows. We have no evidence that any government is supporting ISIS. There are private citizens in certain countries that we know are. And so that's one of the ways we try to cut down on their funding as well. Yes, I'm going to go to you here, and then I'm going to like go around the room, and then I'm going to leave. Then I'm going to cut this briefing off.
I'll stay up
here all day if they don't. Now there's two people standing up giving me the warning. Yes, so let's keep our questions short so I can try to just do maybe three or four more.
This is Jahazeb Ali from Arabi News TV, Pakistan. United States right now and other Western forces spending their resources and energies to eliminate and to expose the ISIL network. Mm-hmm. And no doubt about that, it is a need of the hour. But there is a less concentration towards the other parts of the world, like Afghanistan and its bordering areas with Pakistan. Don't you think that this less concentration, giving them, the Taliban, a chance to rise again, especially after they pull out of American forces?
Well, not at all. I think you've seen one of the reasons we've been able to shift some resources and from a counterterrorism perspective to other places is because we've focused so much on fighting AQ senior leadership in Pakistan and the tribal areas and in Afghanistan. The group that attacked us on 9/11, except for one person, Ayman al-Zawahiri, have been taken off the battlefield, every single one of them. They're replaced with younger, less experienced fighters. It doesn't mean they're not a threat. It doesn't mean we're not focused on it. We certainly have put quite a bit of resources into that fight in Pakistan and Afghanistan. And I will assure you that the United States military members that remain now in Afghanistan are very focused on counterterrorism, are very focused on continuing every day to take the fight to the enemy. And that's something they will remain focused on. We have a number of resources at our disposal in the United States that we can use in a variety of fights. We certainly can do more than one thing at once. So as we focus on terrorist groups where they pop up, whether it's Yemen or Somalia, Iraq and Syria, we remain focused on ones we know exist and we know are concerning, including in Pakistan. Yes, Elliot. And then we're going to do a couple more in the back, and we're going to finish with you. So now I've laid out the plan.
Thanks, Marie. I wanted to ask two quick ones. Last Friday, you and your colleagues at the White House and DOD attracted a lot of attention by saying that the U.S. is at war with ISIL. And mm-hmm. I was wondering if now that a few days have passed since then, if you could tell us what the administration's reasoning was for that decision to change messaging and start calling it a war when previously administration spokespeople had been trying not to use that word.
Well, I think part of it was a recognition that, and this is not a criticism, but that the press was really focused on one word, where we know what we're focused on doing. And I still find myself shocked sometimes that we just focus so much on the terminology, and part of that's my job, is to use words wisely, right? Hopefully I do. But we're at war with ISIL in the same way we're at war with Al-Qaeda. It's not the same kind of war we were at in Iraq before, or even we've been at in Afghanistan. And I think that's probably why you saw some of the hesitancy, because we don't want people equating the two. We don't want people equating the coalitions we're building. We don't want there to be an equation here, because there's not. But, you know, we made the decision to be very clear that that is how we view it. And more importantly, this is how we're going to actually undertake this counterterrorism operation that we are engaged in. I think what's more important is what we're going to do, but I understand the importance of words.
I also wanted to ask whether when Secretary Kerry goes up to New York on Friday, mm-hmm. if there's a chance that he'll be taking part in any of the P5+1 Iran meetings then, or whether that is more of a possibility the following week. What's the outlook on that?
I would say the latter. To my knowledge, he's not scheduled to take place in any P5+1 meetings on Friday. He's going there for this limited purpose. There's always a chance that there'll be ministerial meetings the next week surrounding the P5+1. There were last year, as you know. So I would expect if there is one, it would be the latter. Yes, I'm going to go in the back. Yes, in the middle.
I'm Namo Abdullah with Rudao. I have two questions. The first one, is the ISIS going to be the most important subject discussed in the United Nations General Assembly? And number one,
I think they're all important, but okay. Certainly this is a key topic we'll be discussing.
And the second question is, while you're trying to broaden the anti-ISIS coalition and bringing in more Arab countries on board, Iraq seems to have some reservations about some of those countries. Today, Iraq's president in Paris said that we don't need Sunni Arab countries participate in airstrikes against ISIS. Do you seek Iraq's consent before trying to bring a foreign country on board?
Well, what he actually said was it's not necessary for all contributors to do airstrikes. Everything obviously will be closely coordinated with the Iraqi government. The reason we're taking strikes there now is because they've invited us in. So anything we do will be coordinated with them. And as he said, it's not necessary for everyone to, but each country has a different role to play. Okay, yes, this gentleman back here with the glasses, yes.
Thank you. My name is Frederick Carbon. I'm the correspondent for the French public radio. Mm-hmm. Question about foreign fighters. Mm-hmm. One specific case, name is Mehdi Nemmouche. I'm sure you've heard about him. French citizen fighting in Syria, back in Europe, in Belgium, the attack for Jewish museum in Brussels. Mm-hmm. Do you fear that kind of people, of citizen, European, French people, come to United States with their passports? And are you talking about that with French authorities?
We are with not just the French, but all of our European allies. It's something, I mean, when it comes to the ISIS threat to the homeland, the most concerning thing is Westerners with these passports, particularly Americans, but also Europeans. So when it's Americans, we have ways we can revoke passports. When it's Europeans, we have ways of putting additional screenings on. We're sharing information and intelligence with the Europeans to try and identify these potential threats. That really is the biggest challenge right now we're facing.
How many of those
Now I have to find my numbers again. Now this is, I'm going to have to take like four more questions so I can find my numbers.
Research, what do you ask specifically to French authorities about that, French and other European authorities?
Well, obviously we're sharing a lot of intelligence and information about who is going to Syria and Iraq, who is fighting there, how concerned we are about it. Obviously, there's a number of things we can do in terms of additional screening and preventing these people from coming to the United States or to Europe. Obviously, it's not just about the United States. Part of what we want to do is really cut off this foreign fighter flow so they can't go there and then come back and threaten all of us. And again, I can't find my numbers. I'm just going to give up on the numbers for a second. I'm doing the last question. It's right here. I will look for the numbers for you right now, though, while she asks the last question.
Thank you, Marie. Gita Ariana, yes. Voice of America Persian. I have a question about Iran. You saw today that the IAEA Director General addressed the board of directors and told them that he's not happy with Iran's compliance with the agreements with the agency. On the negotiations track, both sides, both six countries and Iran, each of them are saying that there's still a wide gap between the two sides. You also addressed the possibility, just the possibility of Secretary Kerry joining the group. Right, in New York. Has anybody at the State Department, Secretary Kerry, Undersecretary Sherman, or anybody thought about maybe suggesting to the White House that President Obama once again reach out to the Iranian president and maybe, you know, get the ball rolling again?
We're going to play the will they, won't they game, aren't we, this year, Dunga? We all remember that last year. You know, I have nothing to preview or even speculate on about the president's schedule while at UNGA. The White House can certainly do that. There are gaps that remain, and all you have to do is look at the IAEA saying very clearly that particularly on the potential military dimensions on PMD, this is a challenge. We need to see more out of Iran. We need to see them do more. We need to see them work more closely with the IAEA because this is a fundamental issue that has to be addressed as part of these nuclear negotiations. So, again, this is up to the Iranians to take the right choice here. We want to take advantage of this diplomatic opportunity. All you have to do is look at the rest of the region to see how challenging things are. If we can get this most pressing challenge resolved peacefully, I think that would benefit everybody in the region, certainly the world. We think it's a top priority, and we will see what happens at UNGA next week. And I'm going to finish up by answering his question on foreign fighters, and then my apologies, but I will have to cut the briefing off at that point. Of more than 15,000 foreign fighters, we think it's about 15,000 foreign fighters. So a majority of ISIS's fighters are foreign fighters. We judge at least 2,000 of whom are Westerners. Of the 15,000 foreign fighters, we think they're from more than 80 countries who may have joined ISIL. And more specifically, hundreds of Westerners are fighting with ISIL itself. So those 2,000 are Westerners are fighting with all of the different groups in Iraq and Syria. Hundreds of Westerners are fighting with ISIL, as well as perhaps a dozen or more Americans, specifically with ISIL. Again, a lot of Westerners have gone to fight with Nusra, other random groups there. So I know these are a lot of numbers, but we know it's grown in strength, and it's something we're very focused on. I'm sorry to have to cut this off without getting to... I hate to cut this off. I'm sorry without getting to everyone's questions, but I think I've proven myself that I will come back. I am reliable. And so after the General Assembly, we'll find a time and I'll come back and we can talk about everything that happened, priorities. And again, thanks to everyone for coming today. And if you're going to New York, we'll see you there. Otherwise, see you when we get back.